Okay. Hi, everybody. I'm Michał Dominiak. I'm a student at Wrocław University of Technology in Poland. I work at Nokia Networks. And this is my talk about type-safe configuration library. Okay, so the rough outline. First, the introduction. So why, and yeah, pretty much that. Why type level? Since I'm using those two libraries, I'm going to give a short introduction into them, in case you don't know any of them. Overload resolution control. So it's going to be about the trick that kind of re-implements overload resolution control on top of C++ resolution control. Okay, some traits. We'll put it together in a kind of, we'll put together a class that has another feature, not only the core feature, which will be shown earlier. A single slide on default values, because they are not really hard in this scenario. Constraint configurations. I will explain what that is when we get there. And Boost program options wrapper, when there will mostly be code, so brace for it. Okay, what is this talk about? I like shifting work from runtime to compile time for various reasons. And the simplest one is that at compile time we do the work once. Even if it costs us compile time, we pay that cost once. Not every time we run the code. I like doing that. I like static assertions, not runtime assertions. Avoiding code and constant repetition, we'll get there. Template metaprogramming for some people looks like something outlandish, out of this world, but it can truly be a useful tool. Okay, and some of my experience while writing this code. What is this talk not about? I've written it, I'm using it, but I give no guarantee that the code will, or the interface will not change, since I'm not versioning it yet. And there's probably some subtle problems with it. I hope you can help find some of them today. Okay, this point is here mostly because during the review of proposals, someone said that he hopes that this is not this kind of talk. So it is not. And it's not about reading configuration files. It's kind of covered by the Boost program options wrapper part, because it can read INI files, but it's more of a high-level framework that allows to delegate the work to the lower levels. Yeah, so we won't be parsing files or anything like that. Okay, what's in the title? A configuration is a set of key value pairs, or a map, you could say. That's pretty much all I think it is. There isn't much more to it. Type checks are done at compile time. So we won't get, unless there's a bug, we won't get type errors at runtime. Okay, that's pretty much the goals. Okay, motivation. Property tree or program options aren't really type safe. There is some type erasure going. It loses type information. You have to remember what the type, the value you are getting is. So you have to repeat the type in multiple places. Okay. Strings are terrible. It's pretty much not possible to properly check them at compile time.
That's true. It's still a good choice for keys.
It gets better with constexpr when you kind of can parse it, but it's still not there, I think. Pretty much the only place where the compiler actually checks strings is print. And I can't imagine that that code be nice to read, the compiler code. Yeah, I needed a solution. I will say something more about that in a moment. OK, so that's it. I have this kind of logger thing in a set of personal libraries. And the logger was terrible at some point because all the levels were hard-coded. And they kind of also defined what will the format of the line printed be. So I had like warning, error, info, debug, trace. And at some point I needed a line that said syntax error, not error at the beginning. And at first I added an option to enum that said syntax error. But no, that was just wrong. OK, enums are not extensible. At least not really. You have to write it. You write it once, and you have to keep changing the library if you want to update it. So that's not really an option. Okay, dynamically allocated levels, so that a user, a piece of code, could say, "I want a level between this and this," and it will be formatted like that. But that's not nice. It can have subtle bugs that will not surface for a long, long time. So that was like, no, let's not do that. Maybe enums are the way, but together with something else. So finally, I decided to separate the level and the format part. So for each level, you could have multiple formats. But how to generate those formats if you didn't dynamically allocated them? There would still be the same problems as before. So I chose to use enums to define levels, but to use types to define line format. OK? So yeah, I needed to translate a type to something that defined the format. I could do that, or I could just hard code that translation from type to a value of type vector streamables. But that's not real nice. It's not general. It's, yeah, I didn't like it. Boost N is row. Boost N is are not nice to work with. You can type switch on them, as we've seen yesterday. But yeah, no, that's not nice. OK, type level. It's hard to test code that checks everything in runtime. We strive to get a high coverage of our code in tests. But that's not really possible to check everything. So there can be some weird situations that would only cause an error in production, possibly when deployed. So it's better when it fails at compile time than at runtime. Inlining of templated code is great. The compilers nowadays can pretty much eliminate all the crazy boilerplate and generate the best possible code for the situation in most cases. So that's really nice. OK, I will repeat that again because I strongly believe in that. And I think this is also a valid point, because defining a unique...
Sorry for the interruption, but we're missing the speaker for Flug. Is anybody seeing Jean-Pierre?
No.
OK, sorry again.
OK, defining unique values is not really easy. And defining new types, unique types, is just that, write a struct with a definition. OK.
They have a string as a key, though.
Come again?
They have a string as a key, though. The types.
Okay, the comment is that they have a string as a key, but that's... okay, I get what you are getting at. Okay, kind of a fair point. Okay. So let's talk about the internal implementation. I didn't want to reinvent things, and I wanted to stay as general and portable as possible. So there is Boost.any, which is used as the underlying type erasure implementation. There is Boost.TypeIndex, which is nicer than standard RTTI interface. Okay, so Boost.any allows storing any value. It's possible to ask for the value, and if it fails, so we ask for the wrong value, it's froze. So we get a runtime type error, so to say. Okay, it's what's quick and dirty to use it. So once I start adding more features, it will probably go away in favor of own implementation, or possibly boost type erasure, but that is something I don't fully understand yet. So okay, type index is pretty much RTTI on steroids, and this is, I think, the selling point of it, because it can be very easily made to be usable in environments without RTTI. And this is pretty much it. Oh, that's also a valid point. Okay, so this is the basic implementation. Okay, you can put a value in, you can get it back, and all you need to know is the key. There is a helpful class, or struct rather. It's not very long. I'm using it as kind of a void, but a void with a value. So it can be used in generic contexts to create a value of that type, or to expand the variadic pack of calls without adding comma zero. We'll see that later, yeah. Okay. This is a half of the implementation. Yeah. Set returns a unit. We'll see why later. There is a get that gets a non-const reference. There is a const variant. And there is an unordered map from type index to Boost.any. And this is the part that actually makes something. For a set, it perfectly forwards the arguments into the constructor of the type, saves it in the map, returns a unit. And gets the any at the proper index in the map, and any casts it to the proper type, or to a reference to that type, so we get a reference back. The const version of get is pretty much the same, just with some more consts around. Okay, so there is more coming. This is a technique that I learned from a blog post, beating overload resolutions into submission. Some of you probably know it, but yeah. When you have a set of overloads of a function, and there is multiple Sfine expressions, Sfine conditions that enable them, and the overloads are kind of overlapping in the expression, and you want to order them, you have to order them, otherwise you get ambiguous overloads. Okay. It's this way of doing it is slightly weird or awkward when you need to pass some actual values into into the function we are selecting. So it generates a bit of boilerplate, but I don't think it's too bad, especially since we have lambdas. Okay. Yeah, there will be a link to the post if you want to read the entire post or how he got there from the simplest cases. And I'm going straight into the part that I am in fact using. Okay. I don't want all the Sfine conditions everywhere. And I pretty much always I have a well-defined order of overloads that I want to call in specific situations. It uses overload control, but abuses it slightly. There was a way to make a function take an int and a function taking cvar args and say disable the first one in some conditions. And since int for say zero is always a better match than cvar args, then there would be no ambiguity. Okay. In this case, we're using inheritance. It's an arbitrary limit. It's a single number, basically, somewhere in the code. Okay, so this is it. There is a struct choice defined recursively to inherit from itself, but with a higher index. There is a tail condition for the inheritance. So we have from 0 to 10, so it's 11 different choices. And there is this convenient select overload, which again derives from choice 0. So how this works is select overload differently. Choice 1 is a parent of choice 0, which is in turn parent of select overload, parent class. So when we have a function that two overloads, one that takes a choice 0 and one that takes choice 1, and we pass an instance of select overload, the one that takes choice 0 is always a better match. So there's no ambiguity here. And that's pretty much the technique. This is an example. It's a silly example. It is meant to be silly. Okay, so there is a enable if on n modulo 4 being 0. And there is another one on n being divisible by 2. So normally, those two overloads would be ambiguous, for example, for 8 or for 4. But since we're passing select overload, and this takes choice 0 and this takes choice 1, this one is the better match for overload control. And this is the one that is getting called. Okay. Okay. There is some need for traits. And I will tell you why. Sometimes you want the value kept in configuration saved differently than usually. Or you want to construct it from a type that is not usually convertible to the value held in configuration. This will be especially useful when writing actual options for Boost program options wrapper. Yeah, and I thought about doing it this way. It is an arbitrary design. If you don't agree with it or see a possible better one, please share it. Okay. So yeah, cases to consider. There is an identity construct, so one that takes the value type kept in the tag, and that is to be selected first, because it's a special action that is meant to be taken especially when saving in the configuration. Then, if that doesn't exist, we will just save the value that was passed. then there is an exact construct match. This is a slight lie, because as we'll see soon, the trait for that isn't really truly correctly implemented. There is slight trade-off, but we'll get to that. Then there is a conversion available. There is a matching construct, and there is a matching constructor. That's the order in which we want to call overloads of set that we will add. Those two last choices are pretty much for cases when we are passing multiple values to set. But not only. Okay. Traits. Writing a trait to check for a member of a class is never really nice. Okay. The traits were written, I was writing them as I was writing the rest of the code, and the names are probably not the best names for them that I could think of, but yeah. There was a style of writing traits that also used overload control, that's with, say, int and long, or int and var args. And here it is. This checks if we have, it's not a full check for that case, because it doesn't check that it doesn't check that the value passed is actually the value of the type, but that's checked later. So this just checks that there is a construct member that takes a value of the member type. And this is a Sfina expression. We try to call the function test with zero. So if the member exists, we will get this one. So the return type will be void. And otherwise, it will be char. We are checking if it's void. And then if it is void, we have a public member value, which is true. I've seen this implemented differently. So for example, instead of returning void and char, it was some type defs for yes or no. And there is a checking for size of those, but that doesn't really matter. Okay, so this works, but it's not pretty. It's kind of long. And if you have never seen, well, the same could be said about the other technique, but I think it's harder to learn this than what's coming. Okay, void t. Who didn't heard about void t? Okay. So there is this void t. That's a dependent. That's a template alias. Alias template. Sorry, and we need the first one because there is a defect in the standard. And once it's resolved, we can just do this. So it's basically a way to create a dependent void. Void that is dependent on the template arguments passed to it. Okay. And this is the same trait as before, just written using void t. It's suddenly shorter. There is less magic here, or less things that look like magic. So there is a default template argument void. And the primary definition is a false type, basically. And if this Sfina expression, if construct exists for this type, then this specialization is not eliminated. And then for this void, which is by default there, we are getting a true type. Because this becomes void, so it specializes the trait for the default void here. Okay. It's better. I think we can all agree that it really improves readability of this whole thing. Okay. So this is not a strict requirement here. So I wanted to make it generic, but I could have made it slightly less generic, which would make the task easier, and I could have probably implemented it. And I assume that that everything is passed by values, basically, to avoid having to check for references and const volatile qualifiers, which would generate a massive amount of different specialization of the trait.
Well, couldn't you just remove reference, remove const when you're doing it?
I do use remove reference. Okay, can't I just use remove reference, remove const, and be done with it? I am using remove reference, but at that point, if we remove all the qualifiers, be it ref qualifiers or CV qualifiers, we are no longer looking for an exact match. So we are losing that part. So it's a trade-off. In this case, you would have to write it properly. You would have to write a specialization for the case when the function takes a reference, takes a const reference, takes an R value reference, probably for a const R value reference, where it takes a volatile reference, const volatile reference, all the combinations. So, yeah, I made a trade-off. It's not exactly, the trait doesn't exactly do what its name says, but I think it's good enough for the use case. Okay? There's no easy way. I think there is a way by recursively writing some crazy traits that have a set of types that have their qualifiers specified and set of types for which all the permutations still have to be checked. But that wouldn't be a pretty piece of code. Okay. So this is the trait. It uses an implementation because we have a variadic number of arguments, of template arguments. So we couldn't have a comma type name equals void here at the end. So there's an implementation part that just adds that void at the beginning, not at the end. And there is an alias for adding that. Okay, so by default it's false. And if we can static cast the, okay, here we are forming a type. It's a pointer to a function that takes args, which have their reference removed here. A pointer to a function that takes args and returns whatever construct returns for the arguments. Okay? And we then cast construct to a pointer to that function type. So it basically checks if there is a function called construct in T that takes exactly where this and returns whatever. Okay.
Has exact match equal first template argument is void becomes T in the template?
Nope.
And so then
nope.
T, so void colon.
Nope. It's not. This is the primary definition. And there is a specialization that takes void T, so this takes care of the void here. And then it takes T, which is tag, and takes args, which is this. Okay? All right. There are some helpers. It's same. It it lies, but it checks whether those two names refer to the same type when we drop the reference and const volatile qualifiers. By the way, I found a bug in my code when writing this slide because I had the order of the traits reversed, which doesn't work. Okay. This is part of the boilerplate for using overload resolution control and functions that takes multiple arguments. It may look weird, but basically we are taking a list of types and we are applying the first type and all the types on the list to a trait. Okay. So this is the new set. It still is a perfect forwarding wrapper, but this time we are not just constructing an object, but we are selecting a function from this overload set that we will see some of in a moment. We pass t, we pass the list of types that were passed, and we call that with select overload. We select the correct overload, which in turn returns a lambda, which we don't call, and we return unit. So here's one of the sets. This is where Sfine starts getting kind of in the way. And for the six case, remember, I listed six cases. And if I wanted for the six cases to write all the conditions, which are pretty much always about this size, I would end up with enormous amount of code that is repeated all over the place. So this is really a thing that helps. Okay. So this is the case where we will get a single value. So it's the identity construct case. So we apply on the type list, which is really a single type, but we have to dereference it. So we apply is same on the type that is held by in the configuration at the key defined by t. And we compare that with the type that we are getting here. Well, that the original set got as an argument. And if that is true, and we have a construct that does that, that takes the value of the type that is held, we just call it. There's this static cast that may look weird, but we notice that nowhere here we are checking that the return type of construct is the type that will be held in configuration. So we have to further cast it to the proper type. Okay. Yes?
I'm looking at the automatic capture by reference in your lambda declaration. Are you actually capturing anything right there or not?
I'm capturing this.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
The question was whether I'm capturing anything here or not. I'm capturing this. So yeah. So I can actually call the use map. Okay. This is slightly nicer.
Okay. Do you need to capture this? By
The question is, I could capture this by value. Yes, I could.
But you cannot change this, right?
I could write this instead of the ampersand here, but just this is shorter. That's the reason.
We tend to tell people to make it explicit what you're capturing. It's just easier instead of capturing everything just as a habit.
Yeah, the comment was that we should pretty much capture everything explicitly. I kind of agree, but the lambda here is like an extension of this function, and it operates pretty much in the same context. So that's what this means, right? Yeah, that's kind of a valid point here. Here's the case where we are passed the correct type already, but there is no identity construct. So thanks to this, we don't have to check that thread again, and we can just check that the type is the same. And we just move the value. Okay. Default values. Sometimes we want to have a default value. So a key defines a value, and this is the implementation of that. Again, we have get, an internal implementation of get, and we select the proper overload. This is pretty much the same. It's done in the same way as selecting this proper set. So in case when there is a default value member, we will choose this path. So first we will check whether there is a value in the map under that key. If there isn't, we will create one, and we will then return the reference to the proper type. And when there is no default value, we just return a reference to map at. This should never generate a type error. It can, of course, this unordered maps at can throw if there is no value under that key. But that's something we don't care about really, because it's a feature already implemented, so we are benefiting from that. Okay. Constraint configurations. Okay, that was the first motivation, and we are going to see how my thought process worked here. This was the original idea. We create a tag, and the library somehow automatically knows that tag is there. So extending the values can be performed easily by just creating the tag option, the option object that we will see soon. But I started doing this, and I thought that, wait a second, I'm trying to write something that's type safe, and I'm starting to do type erasure. Something is not quite right here. I cannot check it really. So I can lose some information about what's supposed to be in that configuration. And I want a configuration type that specifies what's in there. So I can always know whether I can get a value of that type, whether I can set it or not. Okay. So we get to constraint configuration, which I called bound configuration. We have the list of types, or really the keys that are allowed here. Okay. At first I only did this part, but then wait a second, that doesn't help anything. So all the keys have a value in there. And we'll see how this is done in a few slides, I think. Okay, so when we are trying to construct bound configuration from another bound configuration, and the bound configuration where we are trying to construct is basically a subset of the other, we can just do that. If that is not the case, we cannot. And there, it's also constructible from ordinary configuration. Just in case there isn't a value we want in that configuration, we will get an exception thrown. Basically, again, by an order of map. There is a private constructor that allows extension of the bounded configuration. But it's private and it's used basically in a single function. Okay. It's a subset. I'm not going to show the code for this here because it's long and it's nothing. There is nothing surprising there. It's straightforward recursion on the type list that checks whether all types in there are in the other set. Okay. There are value reference variants of the functions. They are pretty much the same as the ordinary versions. Modulo stood forward called here and there, so I'm not going to show them. And there's another helper. And it was kind of mentioned multiple times at this conference. There's many ways to actually write that. So here's how I do that. It's again an empty struct that has a constexpr constructor. That's a variadic template. It takes anything and does nothing. So it's used to capture, in a way, or rather swallow, the results of expressions. Different variants I've seen are, for example, type defing swallow to int array, or just creating an array, or wrapping it in a macro, as I think Sebastian's way was. And there's a better way for that in C++ 17, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, fold expressions where you can just write that without silly wrappers like this. But yeah. Okay, and here's the usage of swallow, the first one. We are constructing bound configuration from a configuration. So allowed is a type pack. So this up until here is like a expression pack. So we have to expand it. And in the versions of swallow that are basically an integer array, we have to write paren set allowed config together, comma, zero, closing paren, dot, dot, dot. Which adds some verbosity. And I don't think that the cost of having to return a unit from the function we want to expand is really that bad. I disagree with that point. So, but it's a preference, right? So we are basically getting every value for every key we want in the bound configuration from the original configuration. And then we are setting it locally. So we are basically copying everything from the other configuration. Of course, in case of this being an R value reference, we just move the values instead of copying them. Okay. This is also quite easy. It's basically the same thing, just with the safety put here and not in the runtime checks. So we are checking whether allowed are the subset of others' keys. And if they are, we are doing basically the same thing. Okay, this is set. So it calls configurations set, just first checking whether this is again a trivial function. It checks whether any of the conditions passed as arguments are true. This is again another thing that will be simpler once we have fault expressions, because we'll just be able to write std is same t allowed colon colon value or dot dot dot, and we will just get it for free from the compiler. So this only allows setting a value for a key that is allowed. And the same goes for get. And it would be kind of useless if we just had that set in stone, if we just had the set of types we are allowed to use as keys set in stone, not changeable in any way. So there is a possibility to add new values into the bounded configuration, just it won't be the same object, because we cannot change the type of an object. So we can call a member called add. This allows duplicates, so we cannot have the same key twice. And what it does is basically it copies the configuration it's called on into an extended configuration. It uses the private constructor that basically does no checking whether we can do that or not. So here, temporarily, we have broken invariants, okay? And then we are setting the type we are adding. We are setting the value for the key we are adding to the constraint configuration, and we are returning the new configuration. Similarly, for if this is ref, then we just move this here. Okay, is that clear? Okay. Boost program options. Okay, it's highly configurable. We have to agree on that, I think. Yeah. Yes.
Just quick question: are you going to show the actual usage of this code at some point?
Yeah, there's an usage of program options. I can also. I don't think I've put any slides that are actually just the usage. I can show it to you. I can show you actual code of usage of this class later if you want, so. Or I can show it to you now if you want.
I don't know, it's kind of for me hard to
follow
what
the other
people have. I've got some idea on.
Okay.
I'm not too sure. Because I'm not the only
options. Okay. So here are some tags. So keys into the configuration. We have one or two that store ints, one that stores bool. There is an example construct that takes two different constructs there.
Sorry, just for this, when you have these two constructs, that means that the actual value specified in the whatever configuration file can be the integer or boolean.
It basically means that you can call. Okay, so what does that mean that we have two constructs? It basically means that we can call set with a boolean. And then we will set the string in the configuration either to true or false, or we can call it with an integer, and we will then get a representation of that integer.
Right. Yeah, you mentioned it's actually not about configuration files. It's just like a heterogeneous storage of kind of configuration.
This is not really about configuration files.
So yeah. This would be the schema we've been talking about. But the elements of the schema, what we call options or attributes, are these buckets now.
Mm-hmm. Okay, basically the comment is the comment is that this is something those two guys were discussing earlier. Yeah.
Every week is more than two persons.
Okay. Okay. This is something that was discussed in a library in a week. I didn't hear that part. Okay. Sorry. There is an example that has an identity construct. There is a key that has type bool but actually returns an int from its construct. And there is stack with a default value. Okay. So this is basically the tests file for the class. Okay. Those are asserts. So that's okay. We can set the value for a simple tag to 1, and we get back 1. We can set it again, we get something different. We set the value for a different tag, and we get both. Okay. So this tag's type is bool. So 1 is true when converted to a bool. 0 double is false, and null pointer is also false. So this pretty much does what you would probably expect. This is the type with two constructs. So we can construct it with a string. We can construct it with an integer. This is the tricky situation because you can construct a string from an integer. It's actually not an error to construct a string from an integer. It treats its, I think, as a char. But yeah.
So in this context, your tags are named after the type. You really mean that it's a string type, is that correct? Explicitly constructing tag. What does it stand for? Does it imply it's a string?
It's a name for the value in the configuration. But and it also defines that its value is string. Okay?
So whatever you pass in, it's going to convert to a string.
Come again.
It's going to keep it as a string.
Yes, the any in a map is going to keep a string because that's what we are constructing in all the set overloads. Yeah. I think I've covered the question with the answer. okay. There's this tag that returns integer from integer. Okay.
I think it's a perfect forwarding one.
No, it's the one that returns something else. From its construct, it returns something else from construct that's its underlying type is, and here we are checking that there is actually no type error anywhere. Because if there would, any cast would be thrown here. So we are checking that there is in fact no exception throw. There's tag with default value, so we can just get it and get the same thing that was there as a default value. Okay, there's this is basically code for checking whether invalid sets called on bound configuration compile.
Bound configuration is basically where the set of possible values is fixed.
The question was if bound configuration is a configuration when the set of values is set, the set of keys is set, so therefore the set of things that have a value is also set. Yeah. Okay. There are some checks that we cannot, for example, set simple tag in an empty configuration. Is there anything interesting here? I don't know. Yeah, there are some cases I still have to cover here. Okay.
I think you got the idea.
Okay. Where's my mouse?
Can you go back one slide from where you were? I had a question on the code that you made.
This slide?
Yes. So
okay.
Second line from the bottom, it says that template space set. I'm not familiar with that, what that means.
Okay, the question is what does red.template set mean? Red is a dependent type name here. So we have to tell the compiler that set is a template. So it doesn't interpret it as red. So it doesn't think that in red there is a member called set that we have that we want to less than compare with t. It's a syntactic disambiguation for the case of in calling templates on a template members on dependent type names. No, that's not. Don't you usually write type name? No, no, you write template here. Okay. There is more of dot template coming. So. Okay. Boost program options. Granted that this year's library in a week is about configurations, I guess everyone pretty much knows what program options is, right? Okay. The API is typed, but there is boost any something, and you use strings to retrieve the values, and you have retyped the type, specify it in two places, so it's a nice low-level building block for this high-level framework, okay. Huh? Okay. So this is an example of defining an option. So it's a void option, so an option that doesn't take an argument. So it's either there or not. And we can specify its name. This is the same thing that is later passed as the first argument to boost program options adoption. We can have an option that have whose values is string, and we can also define the description here. And we can have optional options, and the way you specify that is by saying the value type is actually boost optional. Okay. Positional arguments are possible by saying it's a positional argument or is a positional argument. That's first, but there is still something that isn't implemented into your interface. So saying how many of those we want. Right now it's set to one. It's implemented. Support for it is implemented. I just don't know how to properly expose it in the interface. Because we are constructing the option set at compile time. It's a const expr value. So I will have to think about it. So maybe positional taking another tag types that will define whether we are specifying the position or the amount of the arguments. I don't know. But it's implemented, just not possible to specify that the positional argument can be there more than once. Okay. This is an example. We have an example command line. We have basically count two, output is four. And count is an option that whose type is integer. whose name is count. And same goes for the output. It's a string, and its name is output. So we can parse it by passing these type-like things. It's similar to what Louis does in Bushana, if you are familiar with it. Okay. And after that, parsed is a bound configuration of count and output. So we specified that these two arguments are meant to be there, and we now know that they are in fact there. If they would not be, there would be an exception thrown by basically either boost program options or some of the intermediate code. Okay. This is the ugly part. This visible and hidden is implemented for the future, where this will be able to also generate like this. You can. It's a boost program options. I don't remember the name. Options description. Yeah. So normally you can stream it to get a nice help message. It's not yet here, but we are generating it for the case we want some of them visible and some hidden. Okay. We are building that recursively. We will get to this. We are also handling positional arguments. We are building an option description for everything. We are creating a variables map. And then we are basically parsing. This is a placeholder for all the options that I have put there by default. And then we get all the necessary values from boost program options variable map into bound configuration that is initially empty. But we recursively go through all this and get bound configuration with this. Okay. This is pretty. Those two are pretty much the same. So we are just doing different things, whether it's visible or not. And this is again swallow, and we handle the ones that are meant to be visible, which basically adds them here. And here we are adding the not visible ones. Yes.
Can you go back to the previous? So I guess what I don't follow is, if I've got two different options of different names that are the same type, I can't put those in the bound configuration, can I?
The question is, if you have two options with different names whose value type is the same type, you cannot put them in the same bound configuration. You can.
Okay.
Because these types are the tags. So it's there was a simple tag in there, right? Which defined that its type, the type of the value it refers to, is integer.
So for every string that I'm going to get as an option from program options, I have to have a tag.
Yes.
Okay.
And to have two tags with the same type, you'd use inheritance.
To have two tags with the same type.
Something like a position, which is an integer. And I want to have the options X and Y. And I don't want to duplicate the whole construction and so on.
Okay, the question is what to do when you want to duplicate it. So this is kind of it. Because we will see this soon. It's basically a CRTP handler of setting type properly. As you can see, description is also optional. Even name is optional. But it won't end well for arguments that are not positional arguments. OK. Everything clear? No? Okay. This is an option set. So we saw that in case of positional tag. So we there's a single kind of option here. Right now it's positional type, and when we get it, we set position specified to true, position to pos. By the way, this is C++ 14. In 11, because of the const expert, this would be const, and we couldn't change the object in any way. But since in C++ 14, const expert member functions are no longer const, we can do that. And the same goes for the constructor, where we basically initialize with all the arguments we got. And in case we encounter one we don't know, we static assert on a dependent type name, so that it doesn't get, so it gets triggered only when the template is instantiated, not when parsed. False type is an alias template to std false type. Okay, there's position specified. There's position. There is a is visible, which is not handled here, but it's handled in the backend, which I think is a more interesting case because adding options here is pretty relatively easy. And there is always composing, which is set to true, and which basically controls whether a tag that whose type is a vector automatically enables composing, boost program options composing, or not. It's not used yet anywhere, but it will be in the future. Okay, here's the positional type. I don't think there's anything interesting going on here. We have a default constructor, which we use here. We have a constructor that, this is basically a copy constructor, but for it to work at compile time, it has to be written something like in a way like this. And okay. And you can call it with the position that is required, and it basically returns another positional type which does specify the position and has the required position set. It's written this way to be easier to use than it would be if you would have to call positional type constructor directly, and hence the value here. Okay, this is option. This slide is a lie because in the real code there is another template argument which specifies whether the option is meant to be registered in the registered for the original use case I had, so dynamically registering the types. And opt is basically an alias to CRTP value type, comma false. Yeah, but for simplicity I removed that. So name is defined here. It's taken from boost type index type ID. It's the name of the tag. So for positional arguments, you don't have to care to give them a proper stringly name. It will just be generated by default. There's description that is by default empty. There is the count, which is zero. Okay, there is option set that by default is empty. So everything there is false. And there's is void, which is false. And in case of option that takes a void, we cannot store a void. We want to store a boolean that will tell us whether the option was there or not. So it's really an option that stores a bool, but there's this variable set that is later used to determine what to do with it. Okay.
Why not just prevent void?
I don't think it's particularly easy to create a boost program options option that whose value is bool, but that doesn't require an argument. You could have a default argument, right? For the option in boost program options. Mm-hmm. But this there's this the value part. When you construct an option in boost program options, you pass a name, you pass a description, and you pass this boost program options value type object. And there is a special case for passing just a name and the description. And it's handled differently, for example, when outputting the options the options description to a stream.
Okay. I wasn't aware of this esoteric feature.
Yeah. So the question was, why not just disallow void? Okay. There's some helpers. By default, we will have the type we want to tell boost program options it is parsing will be the same type we will be storing, but sometimes it will be not. I had a use case in a project where I'm using this, where the real value was an enumeration, but what I really wanted boost program options to parse was a string, which I could then convert in a specific way to the enum. And there's this. So when you specify a name for a boost program options option, you specify the full name, comma, short name. To enable specifying it differently on the command line. So, and to get the value back, use the full name. So this basically grabs the long name. So this basically grabs the full name, finds a comma, and returns everything that is before the comma. So we can actually get the value from boost program options back. Okay, this is the case I was talking about. So if is void is true, then we will want to use this syntax. Okay, so boost program options treats it kind of differently. And if it isn't, we will handle vector. Handle vector is, I think it's here, but it's basically a function that if the value passed there, if t is a vector, it calls composing on the program options value. And if it's not, it leaves it to be. We remove optional, because boost program options doesn't handle optionals this way. We are handling here by just using boost optional. So we remove it, we get the program options type, which was, this is the meta function on the previous slide, and we set the name, we set the value, and we set the description. Okay. And this is called, it's called for every tag type or option specifier that was passed to parse argval. Handle positional is slightly more interesting. I will not be showing code for sort and filter, because I would probably need at least half an hour more. It basically first filters the types here by whether they are positional or not, and then sorts them in the order. What it does is it doesn't matter in which order you specify the positionals to this library. You can specify the third one, the second one, the first one, and this will sort them and call boost program options properly. Because handling positional arguments is kind of weird in program options. You first have to register the option normally, as if it wasn't positional. And then there's a special type that basically allows you to map, to say how many occurrences of a given option can there be. But you have to do it in order. So if you call the boost program options function with a one type and say one as a second argument, it will always parse that from the first positional option specified. So here we are basically sorting that to tuple ID is basically a identity meta function, which specifies the type that was passed to it as a member. Okay, so we kind of use types as values here. I would really like if types were actual first-class citizens in C++, because this code would be so much easier. So much easier to write and to read. Okay. And this handles, this is this function called here. So we add the by name and by count, we add the given option to positional options description. Okay, this is the fun part. We recursively get all the values we are interested in from the variables map. And get impl is kind of necessary because the get impl are above. And get and this is even above get impl. Because thanks to the glorious idea of order of declarations having a meaning. Because otherwise we couldn't recurse this way. Okay. Okay. Get impl where there is no more values to get from variables map, just forwards the config and returns it. So in this case we still have something to some value to get from variables map, possibly some more. And if it is void, what we do is we add to the configuration a value for that tag, which is count the number of occurrences of its of the value in the map. So basically 0 or 1, whether it was there or not. And then it's converted into a Boolean. So when it was there, the value that is being set is added, really, is true. And when it wasn't there, it's false. If it's optional or if it's vector, for those two cases, this is an arbitrary decision. So if you have a better idea for that part, please share it. Okay, so in those cases, a vector is a container of 0 or more elements. And optional is really a container of 0 or 1 objects. So we treat them the same. So if the value for that option is there, then we get it. This is again the template S. So this is a member of the thing that is returned from the variables map. We grab it by remove optional and from the PO type. So the same thing we did when defining the option from boost program options. And we get the value and we set it. Otherwise, we set the value to the empty value for that type. So either an empty vector or empty boolean. Or empty optional. Okay. if there is a default value in the tag, this is pretty much the same as the previous slide, just we check whether this exists in the map. If so, we grab it and return the new configuration. Otherwise, we add the default value. It's added this way, so not directly, to allow it to be const explore and defined only in a header. Because otherwise, we would be grabbing a reference to this, and then it would need to be defined. It would need a definition, and this way it doesn't need one. So the option together with its default value can be entirely in a header, which I think is a good thing. And this is the default case. I am pretty sure I can minimize this by applying the same principle as before with select overload. I'm not exactly sure how to do it in a nice way. So that's a point to fix in the future. So in the default case, we just add the value we get from the map. And this is the point where it can throw, if it's not there or not. I think this should be an this shouldn't be an operator of, yeah, I think this should be map.add to provide proper error control. Yeah. Okay, so that would be pretty much all. Here's the link for the original blog post about the resolution control. And here you can find, this is the repository for the entire project, set of libraries. And this is the particular place where you can find the implementation for this. Okay.
Can you go back one slide?
Yeah. This?
Yes.
Okay, sorry. Okay.
I think all the slides will be posted in general, right? So that's fine. You just want to look that.
Yes?
So I have from library week.
Okay.
There's one use case I think this system cannot solve.
Okay.
Which might be
merging configurations? Or are you thinking about something else? I will repeat it in a moment. Okay.
I think you could merge configurations.
Yeah, I'd have to write an operator plus or something. Yeah.
Yeah.
I will repeat in a moment. Yeah.
The one use case I think that might be an issue is I'm going to dynamically generate the set of things at runtime. So I don't. So yes, with something off the command line, that's probably not a reasonable scenario.
Okay.
But my use case is outside of the configuration system, I'm going to read some file from the environment, for example. And that's going to tell me
how the other file looks like.
That I have 100, I have 100 devices in my environment, for example. And so I'm going to generate a set of options, a default set of options for all those 100 devices. And then I'm going to read in a config file, which may override some small percentage of those. So my program recognizes that I've got 100 devices, and it can get the options for all of those 100 devices. But I don't think I can do this here because your keys have to be types, right? So I don't think the internal storage can handle my case.
Okay, so the comment is that this implementation doesn't allow for dynamic schemas of configuration. That's what you mean?
Yes.
Okay, that is definitely true. And well, this is the case where you have to decide what you want.
Exactly.
Yeah. So of course this is not for every use case. There's no one single library that covers all the possible use cases.
Okay. And I probably 80% of the use cases, 90, I don't know, don't have that particular case.
Okay. So the comment was that that use case is probably pretty rare.
Well, I'm not sure how rare it is, actually.
Yeah. Yes?
Out of curiosity, if I've got a command line with, say, 10 options, how long does the compile take?
How long does the compilation take?
The compilation
time
depends
okay.
on the number of
yes.
options.
Yes.
And I wonder whether that's linear, quadratic.
I don't know. Okay, the question was what's the complexity of this entire template machinery and how long does it take to compile? I don't know. That's an interesting question. I probably will check it. I would expect it to be kind of linear because it's recursion. I would expect it to be, but I'm not sure. Yeah, that's something I would have to check. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.